The Robe of Paradise. On a lonely, sandy beach in Japan, within sight of Mount Fuji, there stretches a line of ancient pine trees. All of them are windswept and gnarled, and they seem to have been there forever. But only one of them is visited and loved today. For it was by this very tree, long, long ago, that a strange and wonderful thing happened. It was on a hot, windless day at the beginning of summer that a young fisherman, whose name was Hakuryo, was spreading his nets out to dry on the beach with the help of his friend. They had had no luck in catching fish for many days, and Hakuryo was feeling angry and tired and impatient.
Oh, what a life! No wind, no fish, no money. What are we going to do? It's all your fault. You keep saying this is a good place for fish, but we haven't caught a thing for ages.
His friend replied, All my fault? How can you say that? You're a fine one to talk. You never pray to the god of the sea. So how can you expect to catch even the smallest shrimp?
Pray to the god of the sea? I don't believe in that kind of thing. This is a rotten place, that's all.
And Hakuryo threw a pebble into the placid sea.
Look at that. Not a breath of wind. Come on, let's have some lunch and a drink. Soon we won't even have that to enjoy.
So they sat down in the shade of one of the pine trees and ate their simple lunch in gloomy silence. Hakuryo finished the last drops of sake, threw the sake gourd away, and looked out to sea. It was shimmering under the fierce noonday sun, and a small flock of gulls rode quietly on the gentle swell.
See? Even the birds can't find any fish. Oh, it's hopeless. Let's have a nap and see if we can't at least dream about wind and fish and money.
They both dozed off, the singing of the cicadas ringing in their ears. The sky was clear and blue, but as the afternoon wore on, a strange white cloud formed right above the sleeping fishermen, and it slowly began to descend. Hakuryo woke with a start. The cicadas had stopped, and in their place was the sound of celestial voices. Hakuryo sat up quickly. There, on the edge of the sea, was a most wonderful sight. A dazzling creature, clad in a robe of gleaming feathers, was standing staring out to sea. As Hakuryo watched in amazement, the robe slipped from her pale shoulders and fell to the sand in a cascade of rainbow colours. Hakuryo shook his sleeping friend.
Hey, look at that. I don't believe it.
His friend rubbed his eyes and could hardly believe his eyes either. What? He began to say, but Hakuryo quickly put his hand over his friend's mouth and whispered,
Shh, let's hide behind the tree before she notices us.
It was lucky they did, for at that moment, the maiden turned slowly round towards them, stooped gracefully to pick up the robe, and walked up the beach towards the pine tree. She gently hung the robe over the lowest branch and then lightly ran into the sea. Her body seemed to melt into the water with hardly a ripple. Hakuryo's friend stared open-mouthed at the apparition. But Hakuryo's greedy eyes were fixed on the gorgeous robe. He nudged his friend.
Caw, look at that thing. Think how much money we could make if we sold it. We could give up fishing forever.
He jumped up and snatched the robe from the branch. His friend turned to him with a look of horror on his face. No, no, you fool. You mustn't steal it. That isn't an ordinary woman. Don't touch it. It won't do us any good, I'm sure. Hakuryo ignored him and hid behind the tree again, the robe soft and warm in his hand. Suddenly, there was a little cry from the sea. For the maiden had noticed that the robe had gone. The men looked out from behind the trunk of the pine and saw the maiden rushing up the beach. When she reached the tree, she let out a cry of despair which pierced their hearts. And she fell on the sand, sobbing. Hakuryo's friend grabbed the robe and ran out from behind the tree.
No, no, you fool!
Shouted Hakuryo, running out behind him. They stopped in front of the maiden. Very, very slowly, she lifted her head. Her long black hair was full of sand, and tears streaked down her cheeks from her pale eyes. The men were unable to speak. But as soon as she saw the robe, the maiden cried out,
I beg you, sirs, to give me back my robe, for without it, I am powerless to return to my home in paradise.
Hakuryo stepped in front of his friend.
Oh, you're from paradise, are you? Well, you may well talk about paradise. But we are only poor fishermen. There's no hope of paradise for us. But if we sell your robe, our lives here on earth are sure to change for the better.
The tears continued to roll down her fair cheeks, and she begged again.
Have pity on me. I cannot live here on earth. Please believe me. I must return to my home in paradise before the sun sets. And my robe is of no use to you at all. For as soon as you try to sell it, it will turn to worthless dust. Even as my body will vanish into the air. Why do you want to be so cruel and so greedy? I can see that you are poor fishermen, as you say. But if your greed continues, you shall find neither fish, nor friends, nor happiness. Think carefully. Forget your greed, and then your life will change. Please believe me.
Hakuryo looked down at her.
But why should we believe you? We don't know who or what you are.
Look deep into my eyes, Hakuryo, which I believe is your name. Do you see any sign of deceit there? Doubt is the mark of the mortal. With us, there is only the truth. Why do you believe nothing?
Hakuryo stared into the beautiful, clear eyes, and they seemed to run through him like a sword. Suddenly he felt deeply ashamed. He turned his eyes away, took the robe from his friend, and thrust it into her outstretched hands.
Forgive us.
Please forgive us,
he mumbled. The maiden smiled gently as she carefully put the robe over her shoulders.
Hakuryo, I believe you are truly sorry. Perhaps you are really a good man. And now I shall do something for you. I shall dance for you the dance which no mortal has ever seen.
With a laugh like the sound of the wind in the pines, she rose and began her dance for the fisherman. They stood amazed as she floated across the sands, slowly turning and tossing her long, silky hair. And her precious robe trailed like a peacock's tail behind her. She gradually rose higher and higher into the sky. And as she did so, one tiny silver feather fluttered down and fell at Hakuryo's feet. He picked it up and pressed it to his lips as she faded from their sight. For a long time, the two men gazed after her. And for the first time in his life, Hakuryo felt real peace and happiness. And as they stood there, a faint breeze began to blow in from the sea. From that day onwards, Hakuryo and his friend filled their nets with fish. Every day they would visit the place where the maiden from paradise had bathed and offer up their thanks. Hakuryo kept the tiny silver feather with him always, and it was buried with him under the pine tree on that lonely, sandy beach within sight of Mount Fuji.